Hi everyone and welcome. Today we're going to try out this nice micro ATX Super Socket 7 board, the Compaq Mustang-S. It is based on the SiS 530 chipset, which came out in 1998. According to Wikipedia, it supports up to 1.5 GB of RAM, 256 MB of which is cacheable. The board has a whopping 1 MB of cache. The SiS 530 chip includes an AGP video core based on the SiS 6306, which is not particularly fast in 3D, but should be fine for 2D graphics. As you can see, there are solder pads for dedicated video RAM, but they're not populated, so the video card is using part of the system's RAM. There is also an ESS Solo-1 audio chip on board, which works great in DOS. Even though it is a PCI chip, it is very compatible as it supports PC-PCI DMA and serialized IRQ, and also sounds pretty good. If you want to know more about this chip, please refer to Phil's excellent video. The board also has an ISA slot, so you can use an ISA sound card if you choose to do so. There are two issues with this board. Firstly, it is an OEM board with an OEM BIOS, which has limited options. And secondly, it has no AGP slot. I'm going to use the same CPU as I used in the previous video, this K62 Plus 550 MHz. I'm also using the same 64 MB PC100 SDRAM module. For some strange reason, the system would not detect the RAM in DIMM3 slot, so I moved it to DIMM1. Let's power it on. And yeah, we're getting an image. But it stops there and won't post. This may be a processor identification issue, because K62 Plus CPUs are not usually supported out of the box. So let's try with this 533 MHz K62 instead. I will need to bump up the voltage a bit to 2.2 volts. This time it boots fine. Let's run some benchmarks. For some strange reason, SpeedSys won't run the throughput tests. Now if I switch back to the K62 Plus CPU, it will boot, but if I make any change to the hardware, like adding a new card, the BIOS will not post. I got it to boot with the K62 Plus and the Voodoo 3 2000 PCI, so let's run some benchmarks. Well, the results are quite disappointing. The board is slower than the Intel 430TX board from the previous video, despite having a higher FSB and a larger cache. However, the 430TX board running at an 83 MHz FSB had its PCI bus overclocked at 40 MHz, so I guess the PCI bus frequency is more important than the FSB. Anyway, I don't like this Compaq BIOS, so let's try to replace it with a better one. I looked online for other similar SiS 530 boards and started trying out their BIOS images. Most of them wouldn't post, but I found this one from Asoyo, SY-5SSM, that seems to work fine. One issue though that is not immediately apparent is the IRQ assignment. The original BIOS may be configuring the PCI IRQs differently, causing PCI cards not being assigned IRQs. Here's what happens when I plug in a network card. As you can see, the card is not being assigned an IRQ, so it won't work properly. Unlike ISA slots, where all interrupt lines are available to all slots in the same order, PCI interrupts are hardwired differently in each board. Each PCI slot has 4 interrupt pins, int A, int B, int C, and int D. But int A of one slot won't necessarily be connected to int A of another slot. For example, int A of slot 1 may be connected to int B of slot 2. Int B of slot 2 may be connected to int C of slot 3, and so on. This is done in an attempt to spread the load of interrupts across multiple lines, because otherwise most interrupt traffic would be on int A. This routing of IRQ lines is described by the IRQ routing table, and is board-specific, so the BIOS needs to provide the right table, otherwise the cards won't work correctly. So to fix the BIOS, we need to correct the PCI IRQ routing table. But how can we get the IRQ routing table for this Compaq board? Well, we can boot with the original BIOS, then use Craig's PCI tool to dump it. Here's the information we need. Non-zero slots correspond to physical PCI slots on the board. The numbers show the index of the interrupt line that each particular interrupt pin is connected to. But the meaning of these indexes is vendor specific. In this particular case, the numbers are 41 to 44, which probably correspond to the ASCII values for A to D. Anyway, I think that the actual number does not really matter much. The important thing is to know which of the fields have the same number, as this shows how the interrupts are wired. Now that we have the IRQ routing table of the original BIOS, let's open the new BIOS with the awdbedit BIOS editor. The IRQ routing table can be found under System BIOS in the IRQ routing tab. As you can see, in the Soyo BIOS, the interrupt numbers range from 1 to 5. So what we will do is replace 41 with 1, 42 with 2 and so on, and 62 with 5. I'm not super confident that this is the right configuration, but it seems to work, at least on this board. The awdbedit BIOS editor tool does not fix the BIOS checksums, so we need to open it with modbin, make a trivial change like editing the BIOS message and save it. After writing the updated BIOS to the chip, we can boot the system. And as you can see, the network card gets an IRQ just fine. I also patched the BIOS with the BIOS patcher and once again updated the message string with modbin. After booting the system, I tweaked the memory timings a bit. We didn't have access to such options with the original BIOS. Okay, let's run some benchmarks. Yeah, the results are not better, but at least now we have a nicer BIOS to work with. Now let's figure out the undocumented voltage, FSB and multiplier settings using a similar method as in my previous video. This board can theoretically support an FSB of 133 MHz. Let's try it out using a 4x multiplier after switching the memory module with a PC133 one. It does boot, but it's not stable at all. I also disabled the onboard cache and set the video RAM to 0, but that didn't help either. Let's try 124 MHz FSB with a multiplier of 4x. Well, the higher FSB did not make any huge difference, and the system is still not very stable. Now let's try the CPU at 550 MHz. The numbers look a bit better. I tried booting at 600 MHz, but the system was not very stable, with the CPU at 2.2 volts. At this point, the system hanged. Anyway, let's set up the sound card. I used the ESS Solo-1 DOS driver package from Phil's Computer Lab website. Then I made sure that the sound chip uses IRQ5 by tweaking the PNP PCI settings in the BIOS. Then to initialize the card in pure DOS, you need to create a small configuration file in the root directory named ESSSolo.ini. This contains the usual configuration settings, but in binary form, so to create it you need to use a hex editor like Hexit. Please refer to the Vagon's thread linked in the description for more detailed information. Initialization is done by simply running esssolo.com. You may also run the audio mixer called ESSVol. I could not get the SB-Link mode to work, even though both SB-Link pins of the SiS5595 are connected to the ESS chip correctly. Let's try some games.
Your sound card works perfectly.
Now let's check out Windows 98. As you can see, all devices are working well, which suggests that the IRQ routing table is correct. Now let's run 3D Mark 99 with the onboard SiS card. Yeah, it is quite bad. Now let's try 3D Mark 2000. This is a slideshow. We're getting a score of 92, which is very poor. Now let's try the same tests with a Voodoo 3 2000 PCI. 3D Mark 99 is alright, I guess. The Voodoo 3 is struggling a bit in 3D Mark 2000, but the score is more than 10 times higher than with the SiS IGP. But I guess this benchmark is a bit too new for this machine. Oh, and by the way, the SiS graphics card does not seem to have the scrolling bug in games like Jazz Jackrabbit. Okay, that's all for today. I hope you enjoyed the video, and as always, thanks for watching and goodbye!